Hello students, in the last sessions we have discussed different extraction metallurgy, that means how to extract metals from their ores and what are the important ores of iron. So what are the important of ores of iron we have discussed? So the important ores of iron are hematite, magnetite, siderite, limonite. So these things we have discussed in the previous session. And along with that one, we have discussed what is the charge for producing your iron and steel. So what is the charge? Charge is nothing but the raw materials required to extract the iron from its ore is known as charge. So what we are going to give to the furnace to extract iron, so we have discussed in the first session. And later we have discussed where we are going to get these iron ores in our India, and in which locations we are having this iron extraction industries in our India, we have discussed. And later we have discussed the extraction of iron by using our blast furnace. So if you see that in the second session, what we have discussed in the second session, we have discussed the construction of blast furnace. Okay, so how the blast furnace will the structure of the blast furnace will have, that means how the shape and how much height and how much width you are having. And later we have discussed, so what are the different zones of temperature you are having, those things we have discussed. And here also we have discussed what is the charge to the blast furnace. So what is the charge for a blast furnace? It is nothing but your iron ore, coke and limestone. So these will be charged from the top of the blast furnace, and from the bottom of the blast furnace by using tires we are sending hot air, that means a blast of air we are sending, which is used to for the oxidation, what we can call for the burning of this coal, which so the oxygen present in the air, which will be useful for the burning of the coke. Okay, how you will get coke? Dry distillation of coal will get coke. So in coke ovens you will get this coke will be converted into this coal will be converted into coke. Okay, so in this way we are converting coal into coke. And what is the product of this blast furnace? So what are the product of blast furnace we also discussed, that means the main product of the blast furnace is pig iron. And later we have discussed what are the byproducts of a blast furnace. The byproducts of the blast furnace are your hot gases and you are having slag. So the impurities can be removed in the form of slag. So the slag is the byproduct. So slag and your hot gas. Okay. So whatever the furnace hot gases you are getting, those will become the byproducts. So they can be used in different industries for heating applications, and slag is used in the manufacturing of cement industries. Okay. And brick making industries, they can use this slag. And later we have discussed the construction and operation of blast furnace. Okay. So what we are giving, we are giving the charge. So the charge is coming from top to bottom. And you are sending hot air, blast of hot air from bottom to top. So when it is moving, so what is having, when the charge is descending down, that means when the charge is moving from top to bottom, what is happening? The temperature is increasing. When the temperature is increasing, what will happen? So the molten metal, the ore and will melt, and at different temperatures different chemical reactions will takes place. Because of that chemical reactions, what you are going to get, you are going to get the impurities will be get reacted with your limestone and forms slag. So here limestone acts as flux, so it combines with the impurities and forms a slag, and which is lighter compared to your pig iron which is in molten state. So the pig iron molten, the pig iron which is in the molten state settles on the hearth. On that one your slag is floating. So we can remove that slag and later we can tap the pig iron. Okay, so this is the generally, this is the general procedure what we have how to manufacture pig iron from iron ore by using blast furnace, we have discussed in the second session. Right? In that one also, we have discussed different reactions. So what are the reactions that will took place in the blast furnace to get pig iron? Okay, so those the reactions also we have discussed, and later we have discussed the application part. So here we are not having any applications because pig iron is not suitable for industrial applications directly. Why? Because it is inferior. That means the properties are not suitable for industrial applications. So we should send them to further refining by in molten state or by cast. By sending into the molds and making it solidify, and later we can use, or directly by molten state or we can use for further refinement, then only we can use that one for the industrial applications. So here, what are the important factors that is important concepts we have discussed? So what is pig iron, and what is the construction and operation of a blast furnace, and what are the reactions that took place in the blast furnace? What is the charge of a blast furnace? What is the product and byproducts of a blast furnace? And later we have discussed what are the functions of a charge. So in the charge, what you are having, iron ore and later coke and limestone. So iron ore, already we know that. So it is having the element. So what we are going to extract, that iron. Iron is the constituent of this iron ore. So iron ore is used. So the function of iron ore is, as it is having that iron as the constituent, so from that one we are going to get this iron. So and the second one is coke. So what is the use of a coke? So coke will act as a reducing agent, and it also provides heat. So coke will act as a reducing agent as well as it supplies the heat, so while burning. And the third one is limestone. What is the use of limestone? Limestone will act as a flux, and this flux reacts with impurities and forms slag, and that can be removed off. That means for removing the impurities, this limestone is very, very essential because it acts as a flux. What is the nature of a flux and what is the function of a flux? A flux reacts with the impurities and forms slag, which floats on the liquid molten metal, and it can be removed off. Okay, so these things we have discussed in the second session. And coming to third session, in the third session, what we have discussed, in the third session, we have discussed manufacture, that is production of wrought iron from the puddling furnace. Okay, so how the puddling furnace construction will be there, and what are the operations, and how wrought iron is made from this puddling furnace, we have discussed. So first we have to discuss about wrought iron. So what is wrought iron? It is the purest form of iron. So how you are going to get this wrought iron? From pig iron, because I already told you pig iron is not suitable for industrial applications because it is not having sufficient properties which is suitable for industrial applications. So what we have to do, we have to refine it. So the pig iron should be refined. So for that purpose, what we are doing, we are using this pig iron as charge, and we are making some chemical reactions in the puddling furnace, and later so some operation will take place in the puddling furnace, and at the end what you are going to get, you are going to get wrought iron. So what is happening in this one? So you are giving pig iron and you are getting wrought iron. In between you are having some process. In that process the impurities are removed. So what are the impurities generally that can be removed off? Silicon, manganese, phosphorus and carbon. Silicon, manganese and phosphorus, they can form as slag and they can be removed off. And if you see the carbon, the carbon will be forms as carbon dioxide and it can be removed off. So in this way we are removing the impurities, and later we are going to get this wrought iron. So in wrought iron the composition is 99% iron you are having and 1% impurities. So 1% impurities is generally silicon, manganese, phosphorus and carbon. Okay, so the impurities percentage is only 1%, so that's why we can call it as it is the purest form of iron. So how the construction of a your puddling furnace? The other name for the puddling furnace is reverberatory furnace. So why we can call it as reverberatory furnace? If you see the roof, you are having a low roof and which is in the form of a dome shape. When the flame touches the roof, what will happen? It will reflect back onto the charge. It will reflect on back onto the hearth. So it is deflecting. So because of that nature, it can be called as reverberatory furnace. So here on the hearth, what you are having? You are having iron oxide. So and during the process, at regular intervals, what we are going to do, we are going to add this iron oxide for the oxidation purpose. So here, what we are going to do, we are operating fettling operation. Fettling, what is meant by fettling operation? Here in fettling operation means, at high temperatures, what we are going to do, in a furnace, we are removing the impurities by oxidation. So that process is known as fettling operation. I am repeating once again. So what is fettling operation? We are removing the impurities from the pig iron at high temperatures in a furnace by oxidation method. So by oxidizing them, we are removing it. So this process is known as fettling process or fettling operation. Okay. So here the silicon, manganese, phosphorus, and carbon are removed. Okay. So and this process is known as fettling operation. After that one only, you are going to get wrought iron. So you are having coke from that one. You are getting the heat, and on the char, on the hearth, you are having the lining of iron oxide hematite, and you are giving pig iron in the form of semi-liquid state from the charging doors. So when the furnace is fired, what will happen? Because of the heat, the molten metal, that means the pig iron, will melt, and the reaction, that means oxidation process, will take place to get more oxidation. What we have to do? We have to send a fresh air blast into the furnace such that it can react with the metal, and it gives the oxygen, and because of that oxygen, oxidation process will take place. Because of that oxidation process, what will happen? The impurities will be removed. So to get that more, that means if you want to get oxygen should come contact with the complete metal, what we have to do? We have to stir it properly. That means regularly, continuously, you have to stir the molten metal such that the oxygen can react with the impurities that present in the metal. So such that you have to stir it. So this stirring process, what we are doing, you are continuously stirring, that is nothing but puddling. So that's why it is called as a puddling furnace. Okay. So in this way, we are having the continuous process. So after that, you are having three stages of reactions. In the first stage, this your silicon, manganese, and sulfur can be removed off. And in the second stage, your phosphorus pig can be removed off. And in the third stage, your carbon will be removed off. So in this way, the impurities can be removed from the molten metal. And later, so the molten metal, that means your wrought iron, can be tapped. And if you see the properties, when you compare to pig iron, it is having good properties. That means the impurities are removed, so the properties will be changed, and these properties are suitable for industrial applications. So we are having, it is having low strength, but it is having weldability and forgeability properties, and it is having good ductility property. So because of these natures, we can use this one in different applications of engineering, that is plates and railway couplings. So for making of those things, we can use. So we have discussed all these things, the properties and the applications of wrought iron in the previous session. Okay. So today what we are going to do, if you see here, today what we are going to do, we are going to discuss this production of cast iron in cupola. Okay. So this cupola, I think you have studied this cupola in the first year, just construction of cupola. That means in the foundry process, you may come across this cupola furnace, but we have not discussed in detail at that time regarding cupola. But here we are going to discuss in detail that construction and operation of cupola, and how the cast iron will be manufactured by using cupola. Those things we are going to discuss in this session. Okay. So we will see how the things will be. See here. If you see here, so we are going to discuss the production of cast iron in cupola. And if you see what the things we have discussed just now, I given elaborately I have discussed what we have discussed in the previous sessions. And if you see here, so that is extraction of metals. So how the extraction of metals will be takes place, and what are the methods we are having, we have discussed. And production of pig iron in a blast furnace and composition of pig iron, and production of wrought iron in puddling furnace and composition of wrought iron and applications. All these things we have discussed in the previous three sessions. So in the first session, we have discussed this extraction of metals and types of extraction metals and the charge for the production of iron and steel and introduction. And later we have discussed production of pig iron and later production of wrought iron. These things we have discussed in the previous sessions. And if you coming to today's session, what we are going to discuss, see here, these are the things we are going to discuss in today's session. That is, what is cast iron? So what is cast iron we are going to discuss, and manufacturing of cast iron in a cupola furnace, how the construction of a cupola furnace, and what are the operation of a cupola furnace, and how the cast iron is made in cupola furnace we will discuss. And cupola furnace constructional details, raw materials, so what is the charge into the cupola, so how it will be made, so is there any so generally we will take pig iron. In addition to that pig iron, can you take some other thing? So those things we are going to discuss in raw materials, and later we will discuss the operation of cupola furnace to produce cast iron. So these things we are going to discuss. If you see here, so this is the principle we can say. So how the your cast iron is made, see here. So you are getting your end product here is cast iron. So that means your final product is cast iron you are going to get. So how you are going to get? If you see the flow chart, that means this is the principle we can say. So you have to use 75% of pig iron. So where we can make this pig iron? So it is the product of your blast furnace. So from the blast furnace, you are going to get this pig iron. So you have to take 75% of the pig iron, and you have to take 25%. So here we are having 75% pig iron and 25% steel scrap and coke and lime. This can be taken as the raw materials for the production of cast iron by using cupola. So later what you are having, air blast and firing in cupola furnace. So you will take this as charge, and later what you will do, you will fire the furnace by supplying air blast, and because of that one, what will happen, molten iron will be formed, and that can be tapped into ladle and cast into molds. So cast iron, so it can be cast into the molds, and later you will get the cast iron. Okay, so this is the general flow process, a flow chart for the manufacturing of, for the production of cast iron by using cupola furnace. So here what you are doing, what you are taking the as the raw material, 75% pig iron, 25% steel scrap, and coke and limestone. So this is the principle. If in the examination they ask, write the principle of production of cast iron, so you have to write this one. So what we are doing, we are taking charge as 75% pig iron, 25% steel scrap, and coke and lime we are taking, and later we are firing the furnace by supplying air blast, and later what you will get, different reactions will take place. Later you will get molten iron. That molten iron can be tapped, and that will be sent to the molds to get cast iron. So this is the principle and flow chart for the production of cast iron from cupola. See, and very, very important one, the next one is construction of cupola furnace. So how the furnace will be, we will see here. This is very, very important in the examination, constructional details. So here I will show you the diagram later. See here, cylindrical shell lined with fire bricks. So here if you see the cupola furnace, the shape of the cupola furnace is cylindrical shell, and it is lined with fire bricks. See, why I am always saying fire bricks, why we should do? Because inside the furnace, high temperature will be developed, right? So fire bricks are nothing but which are having high refractoriness. What is meant by refractoriness? Refractoriness is nothing but it can capable, that means it is the ability of the material to resist high temperatures. So refractory materials are able to resist high temperatures. So that's why we have to use these fire bricks inside the cylindrical cell such that it can withstand high temperatures. Okay, so that's why if you take any furnace, what we will do inside walls, for the inside walls we have to give the refractory lining, whether it is bricks or something else or some coating. So what you have to do, you have to give the refractory coating or refractory lining. Okay, so that's why here the cylindrical shell is lined with fire bricks, and shell diameter generally it is from 0.9 meters to 2 meters. The diameter will be 0.9 meters to 2 meters, and height is 4 to 5 times of your diameter. So 0.9 into 4 or 0.9 into 5 or 2 into 4 or 2 into 5. So that will be the range for your height. So cell diameter varies from 0.9 meters to 2 meters, and height varies 4 to 5 times of whatever the diameter you have taken. For the diameter, the height will varies from 4 to 5 times. On bottom, if you see the on bottom, you are having 100 to 150 mm thick sand bed will be there. So why we are having this sand? Because it is having some slope and you are having a sand bed. So you are having sand bed here for collection of your molten metal. So here on the sand bed, what will happen when the metal melts, it will settle down on the sand bed, and which is having a slope. Because of that slope, it can move into the mold cavities. Okay, so on bottom what you are having 100 mm to 150 mm thick sand bed is there, which is having some slope. So why you are maintaining that slope? Because for the flow of molten metal, and dry wood is placed on the sand bed. Okay, so if you see here, dry wood is placed on the sand bed. So on that sand bed you are having this dry wood for the collection of your molten metal. Coke charged on bed, 0.75 meters above the tires. Generally, where this coke is supplied, because of this coke only you are getting the heat. So what is meant by these tires? Tires are nothing but those are used to supply the air blast. So tires are nothing but which are used for supply of air blast. So you have to charge the coke above 0.75 meters above the tires. That means you have to take a distance, that means you have to take a height of 0.75 meters from the tires arrangement. So when the tires is here, you have to take 0.75 meters high, and from that one, what you have to do? You have to supply the coke. So this is the constructional details. I am repeating once again. If you see here, cylindrical shell is lined with fire bricks. So you are having a cylindrical shell. So if you take a cupola furnace, you are having a cylindrical shell. In that cylindrical shell, the inner portion should be lined with the fire bricks. Fire bricks are nothing but refractory material. Refractory materials, what is meant by refractory material? Which are able to resist high temperatures. Those are known as refractory materials. And if you see the shell diameter, so cupola diameter, generally it will be 0.9 meters to 2 meters. And the height of the cupola varies from 4 to 5 times of your diameter taken. And on the bottom side, what you are having? You are having a sand bed which is having a thickness of 100 to 150 mm thick on that one. So it is having, the sand bed is having one type, that means one side you are having slope. On that slope, on that sand, what you are having? You are having hard wood will be placed. So for the collection of molten metal. And how the coke will be charged? So how the coke will be charged in the cupola, it should be charged above 0.75 meters from the tires where this air blast can be supplied. So from the tires, air blast can be supplied, and from that one, you have to take 0.75 meters and there you have to supply the coke. That means you have to charge the coke into the cupola furnace. So this is the constructional details of a cupola furnace. Very, very important. In the examination, they will ask, draw a neat sketch of cupola and explain its construction and operation details. So this is the constructional details you have to mention. So these are the main points to mention. You can frame a beautiful sentence by using these concepts. And you can describe the constructional details here. And later, if you come to see here, next. Okay, see, next one. Next, just now we have discussed what is the charge. So what is the charge we are going to give to the cupola furnace? So what is the charge here? If you see, what is the charge we are going to give? If you see here, so the charge consists of metal. In that metal, you are having 75% pig iron. So you are having 75% pig iron, and you are having 25% of steel scrap. So 25% steel scrap and coke and limestone. So you are having metal. In that metal, 75% of pig iron and 25% of steel scrap. So this steel scrap you will get from outside, and your 75% of pig iron. So that can be, that is the product of your blast furnace. So you will mix this steel scrap with your pig iron, and it can be used as your metal for the, in the charge for the cupola furnace, and you have to take coke and limestone. And if you see, the above materials are arranged in alternate layers on burning on coke bed. So you have to arrange them in a alternate layers. Okay, already we have discussed this one in the blast furnace also. What we have to do, we have to place them on in alternate layers. And if you see here, so these materials should be arranged in alternate layers. And if you see this one, 1 ton of coke and 10 tons of metal and 0.2 tons of lime should be taken. So this is the proportion. So in this proportion, you have to take the charge. That means 1 ton of coke, 1 ton of coke and 10 tons of metal and 0.2 tons of your lime. Okay, so you have to take 1 ton of coke and 10 tons of metal. Metal means 75% pig iron and 25% steel scrap combined together, and 0.25 tons of lime. This should be taken as charge. Very, very important question. What is the charge for cupola furnace for manufacturing of cast iron? So this is the charge for manufacturing, that is production of cast iron by using cupola. Okay, very, very important question this one. So you should able to answer. So what are the charge we are having? We are having metal, steel scrap, coke and limestone. So here the metal is consists of 75% pig iron and 25% of steel scrap and coke and limestone. And they can be arranged in alternate layers, but how the proportion we should take? That means what is the proportion of these three elements? Elements are nothing but your metal, coke and limestone. So what is the proportionate proportional, how they are in what proportion we have to take? 1 ton of coke we should take, and 10 tons of metal and 0.2 tons of lime. So if you take 1 ton of coke, you have to take 10 tons of metal. That means 7.5 tons of pig iron and 2.5 tons of steel scrap. So in 10 tons and 0.2 tons of lime, we should take as charge to the cupola. And if you go for the next one, see, this one is the cupola furnace. If you see here, you are having a cylindrical shell. So this is your cylindrical shell. So you are having charge floor and handle to open and close the tires. So tires are nothing but to supply the air blast. So from here, charging door, you are having a charging door, and upper tire blast inlet you are having here, bottom plate, lug for raising the door. So here you are having spark arrestor at the top. So this is a cupola furnace. See, this is very, very important. This diagram you have to draw in the examination. Okay, this is for only understanding purpose, this diagram. But this one is very, very important here. So here you have to understand it. If you see here, if you see the constructional details, see here, charging door you are having. This is the charging floor. From this one, you can charge the charge, and you are having refractory. I will show you one by one. See here, this is the charging door, and you are having charging floor. You are having charging floor, and here if you see the refractory lining wind box, so here you are having refractory lining. This should be refractory lining, and the blast pipe, that means you are having a blast pipe and slag spout. So for removing slag, you are having this one, and this fettling hole and tapping hole for metal tapping, this one, and you are having tires. So this is also tires, and from this one you are going to get molten metal. Okay, and this is the sand bed. So this is the sand bed what we have discussed, and if you see, it is having slope. It is having slope towards this one, and this is the shell. This is the outer shell, and low inner shell is lined with refractory material. And if you see this one, this is the stock portion. From here to here, this is known as stock portion, and this is the preheating zone. This is the preheating zone, and here in this zone, the metal will melt, and this is the superheating zone. And after superheating zone, what will happen? The reactions will take place, and the impurities are removed in the form of slag by using this slag spout. And this is the collection of here. The molten metal will be collected here. So from this one, we can collect the molten material. So this is the construction. So you have to draw this diagram in the examination, and you have to identify different points and different sections and different zones. And you have to mark them on the diagram, and later you have to explain the constructional details what we have discussed just now. Okay, so that gives the diagram and constructional details and the charge. So just now we have discussed the charge. So that gives the diagram, constructional details, and charge of a cupola furnace. I am repeating once again. So here you are having a spark arrestor here. If you see the diagram, so the spark can be arrested here. And you are having charging floor and charging door. And if you see from the tires, you are having the charging door is at a certain height, 0.75 meters from that one. And you are having melting zone and preheating zone and superheating zone. And later you are having this all surrounding are tires you are having for the supply of air blast. And from here you can remove the slag which floats on the molten material. And this molten material can be tapped here. And you are having a sand bed. On that sand bed, you are having hardwood, dry hardwood you are having. So from that one, you can easily tap the molten metal. That is, it can be sent to the different molds for casting. In this way, we are going to produce cast iron by using cupola furnace. See, operation of cupola. So first, coke first lit at the bottom. So first you have to fire the coke. So first you have to fire the coke at the bottom, and cupola charged from the charging door up to the bottom door. So you have to charge the coke, charging, that means charge is nothing but your metal, coke and limestone. That should be charged from the charging door up to the bottom door. And next, alternate layers of metal, coke and limestone should be placed, and air blast put on tires. Later, what we have to do, we have to supply the air blast. So we have to do these steps. First, what we have to do, we have to fire the coke at the bottom, and later you have to charge the charge from the charging door up to the bottom door. And the charge should be in alternate layers. So in charge, we are having metal, coke, and limestone, and air blast. Later, what we have to do, we have to put on the air blast through the tires. So these are the steps we should follow in the operation of the cupola furnace. And after that, when you do that one, what you are having different zones of temperature. That means preheating zone, melting zone, and superheating zone. So here it will be preheated, and in here in the melting zone, it will melt, and in the superheating zone, so your slag will be formed, and the metal will be at the it will be settled down on the hardwood, which is placed on the sand bed. So what are the heating zones we are having? This may be asked in the examination. List out different heating zones in cupola furnace. So preheating zone, melting zone, and superheating zone. So these are the three zones that are available in our cupola furnace. See here, if you see, so this is your charging door, and if you see here, if the temperatures are seen, so here you are having this is your preheating zone, and this is the melting zone. That means temperature will be increased, and reduction zone. And from this one here, what you will get, you will get your superheating zone. And here, if you see, oxidation zone will here oxidation will takes place. Here the reduction, and you are having, these are the tires for air blast. If you see this one, your sand bed, and that sand bed, if you see the yellow color, this yellow color is the metal, and from here you can tap the metal. So these are the important zones. So you are having preheating zone, melting zone, and superheating zone. So these are the three heating zones that presents in a cupola furnace. And what are the reactions? If you see, limestone melts and forms a flux. So all we know that. So this limestone function is, it acts as a flux. So what is the function of a flux? Flux reacts with the impurities and forms slag that can be removed off. And flux protects the metal from excessive oxidation. So not only it removes the impurities, it also protects the metal from excess of oxidation. That means it should not form iron oxide, and lime fuses and forms slag with coke ash, so that can be removed off. And hot gases rise through the furnace and melts the iron. Already we have discussed. So 1% of silicon and 1.5% of manganese oxidize, and phosphorus remains unchanged. So molten iron and slag taken out in a separate notches, and the molten iron is tapped into the ladle and cast into the molds. So first, what we have to do, we have to remove the slag which is having impurities, and later we have to tap the molten metal, and that can be sent into to the molds for the casting purpose. So if you see the composition of cast iron, so how the composition of cast iron will be, so this is the composition of cast iron we are going to discuss. If you see, so how much iron percentage you are having? You are having a percentage of 92 to 96% iron is there, and carbon percentage is 2.5 to 3.75%, and silicon from 1 to 2.5%, and manganese from 0.4 to 1% you are having, and sulfur 0.06 to 0.12, and phosphorus 0.1 to 1% you are having. 0.1 to 1% you are having. Okay. So this is the composition. So you should remember this composition. In the examination, they will ask, what is the composition of cast iron? So you have to write this one. So these are the impurities. Okay. So these are the impurities, and this is the iron and carbon percentage. Okay. So in the coming chapters, what we are going to discuss, we are going to discuss this effect of carbon. Okay, so here in the cast iron, when we can call it as a cast iron and when we can call it as a steel, so those things we will discuss in the iron carbon equilibrium diagram. So this carbon percentage plays a vital role in deciding the mechanical properties. So this here generally it will be 2.5 to 3.75 in the cast iron. Okay, so this is the composition of our cast iron. See, see here what we have discussed till now. So we have discussed construction of cupola. We have discussed construction of cupola and operation of cupola furnace and reactions and production of cast iron and cast iron composition. Okay, so the if you go for the cupola furnace construction, how the shape of the cupola, it is a cylindrical shell, and in that cylindrical shell inside you are having, that is refractory material lining, generally fire bricks. So the inside of the shell should be lined with refractory material, and you are having a charging door. So what is the height? So we have discussed the how much height should be there. So it depends on the diameter. So it is 4 to 5 times of diameter you have taken, and from that one you have to fix the height, and you are having charging door and the bottom door, and you have to place the this charge from charging door to the bottom door. Okay, and how, which charge we have to take, and in which proportion we have to take. So charge consists of your metal, coke and limestone. In metal, 75% of pig iron and 25% of your steel scrap should be taken. And if you come to this coke and metal and limestone, they should be taken in proportion of 1 ton of coke and 10 tons of metal and 0.2 tons of limestone should be taken. Okay, so in this proportion we have to take. And if you go for the constructional details, so height we have discussed, and the diameter, and you are having a spark arrestor at the top, and at the bottom you are having a sand bed, and that's which is having toward one side it is having some inclination, and that one you are having hardwood for a collection of molten metal. And from that one, when you burn the coke, so operation of cupola, what will happen? So you have to supply the charge to the charging door, which is 0.75 meters away from the tires. The tires are used for supply of air blast. So there you are supplying the charge. The charge should be in layers, layer by layer. And first what we have to do, we have to ignite the, your coke at the bottom, and we have to charge the from the charge door. What will happen when you send the air blast? Because of that air blast, when the charge is moving down, it can melt. You are having different heating zones, preheating zone, melting zone and superheating zone. In the melting zone, what will happen? The molten metal will melt and different reactions will take place. So reactions also we have discussed. So from that one, you will get slag will be formed with the impurities. That slag can be removed off from the slag hole, and later your molten metal settles on the bed, and which can be tapped easily, and it can be sent to the molds for the for casting purpose. So in this way we are going to get the cast iron. Okay, so cast iron composition, just now we have discussed cast iron composition. So how much percentage of iron, carbon, your other impurities will be there, that will become the composition of cast iron. So these things we have discussed in today's session. Okay, you see here, see, just now we have discussed this composition of cast iron. So what is the composition of cast iron? 92-96% of carbon, 2.5 to 3.75 silicon, carbon, and silicon 1 to 2.5, manganese 0.4 to 1, and sulfur 0.06 to 0.12, and phosphorus 0.1 to 1%. So this is the, you have to remember this percentage and ratio of diameter to height of cupola 1:4, 4 to 5 generally, so minimum is 4. And charge consists of, so what is the charge for a cupola furnace? Your pig iron scrap, that means metal and limestone and coke. One more thing is coke, it is missing here, so coke is there. So generally, these are the frequently asked questions. If you see, these are the frequently asked questions. What is the charge used in cupola? And explain the production of cast iron cupola. So if you are, if they ask this one, you have to explain, you have to draw the diagram, you have to write the what is the charge, and you have to explain the constructional details and the operation details and the product, that is the different reactions and heating zones, and how the cast iron will be produced and what is its composition. Everything you have to write in this one. That means explain production of cast iron and in cupola furnace. Okay. So with this one, I am closing today's session.